Florida Gators have lost seven starters to injuries this year, including the Southeastern Conference leading rusher Emmett Smith. Also, their top receiver and leader on and off the field, Stacy Simmons, hurt his knee against LSU, and he'll miss the remainder of this season. But Florida has hung tough with their defense, third in the nation in both scoring and total defense. Richard Fain with a pick for a touchdown here against LSU. They'll have to play with pride this week against Auburn. It's homecoming at Florida, so grab a seat. Everybody, and we welcome you to Gainesville, Florida. It is homecoming Saturday here as the Auburn Tigers get set to go against the Florida Gators, and homecoming means Gator growl. It happened last night right here at Florida Field, the 63rd Gator growl. And Lee, you've seen it before. Anybody who's ever been around Florida football has seen it. It's quite a spectacle, and here's how it looked. Florida University kicked off its homecoming weekend with an afternoon parade down Main Street of Gainesville. The homecoming queens joined the festivities as they awaited the results to be announced at the 63rd annual Gator Growl that evening. Floats were the big attraction at the parade as students competed against one another for first prize. Football was the last thing on the students' mind last night as that 63rd annual Gator Growl got underway. Over 75,000 Florida students and alumni piled into Florida Field for the largest student-run event in the country. And there was no doubt in the minds of the crowd who won the homecoming queen contest. It was 21-year-old Missy Madola.
In an angel of university.
Coordination of the Gator Growl is a huge responsibility that falls in the hands of the most competent Florida student each year. This year's planning was done by Joe Cavett Jr.
I started working on Gator Growl in January, and we have a budget of over $500,000, and we consider this to be the largest student-produced show and pep rally in the world. And it's just a tradition that's been going on for 63 years, and we're very proud of what we've got here at the University of Florida.
The biggest winner of the evening, though, came from Jacksonville, Florida, as Robert Rowell won $1 million in the Florida State Lottery. The main attraction for the Gator Growl was comedian Stephen Wright. He's appeared on Saturday Night Live and David Letterman. After the show, Stephen reminisced about his old chess days at Emerson College in Boston, Mass.
It was little. It was 1,400 people, and we didn't have any teams or anything. It was a really weird school. We had a dark chess team. Very violent, though. We wore the pads anyway.
Record?
111 and 102. 111 wins, 110 losses. Yeah, it was 10th game. All right. I knighted the guy right at the buzzer.
That was Stephen Wright, and what a spectacle last night. Homecoming here in Florida. Lee, you've probably seen more homecomings from more different schools than anybody in the world.
But nobody does it better than the Florida Gators and their Gator Growl. No one.
All the talk here in Gainesville this week has been to the status of Emmett Smith, their All-American running back. He hurt his knee against Memphis State. They had an off week. Smith said earlier this week that he was going to play this weekend against Auburn. It came down to between Auburn and Florida where he goes to school. Galen Hall, though, said no, he wouldn't play, and the coach always wins those arguments. Lee, Florida's had seven starters out this year. They go up against one of the top defenses in the nation. What can they do?
Well, I wouldn't be surprised to see the offensive coaches come up with a different game plan. Maybe three tight ends. They might even come up with some special plays. They've got to try to score on big plays. Offense, defense, and the kicking game. They must try to contain the Auburn run and then put the pressure on number 17, Slack. He has not been overly impressive in the two games against LSU and Kentucky. In fact, they've only scored. Auburn has 26 points against those two good football teams.
Yes, and in a particular game against LSU, they didn't score a touchdown. The two TDs against Kentucky were both
on the ground. Now, let's talk a little bit about the Auburn Tigers, because they are a tremendous football team. You put Auburn on paper, you put Florida on paper, there's no way Auburn can lose.
Yeah, but Florida's beaten Auburn seven times in a row here. And in fact, of all the games that Pat Dye's won, he's never beaten Florida in Gainesville.
So we talk about teams and how do they win football games. So how does Auburn lose this game?
Well, first of all, their offense can't shoot themselves in the foot. In other words, they can't turn the ball over with pass offensive penalties or anything like that. Control the ball. Move the ball. They had the ball 94 times against Mississippi State. They can win that way. Intimidate the Florida offense. Florida is unsure of themselves. Go after them.
And now the teams will come out of the field, and first of all, the Tigers of Auburn. This is a very important game in the Southeastern Conference, because there are five teams in the conference with just one loss. And in the 54-year history of the Southeastern Conference, no school has ever won the title with two losses.
This is a big game for both teams, but especially for Galen Hall. This is a big game for him in homecoming.
Florida has lost two games in a row to Memphis State and Vanderbilt. They're coming from an off week. Meanwhile, Auburn, they've just been tearing things up as the Florida Gators take the field now at Florida Field. ESPN's presentation of CFA football is being brought to you by Heil Heating and Cooling. Depend on Heil, they're born to run. And by Allstate, for home, auto, and life insurance, you're in good hands with Allstate. Now a look at those standings. Georgia at 4-1, Auburn, Alabama, Florida, and LSU, all with just one loss apiece.
Leave it to the good hands.
First meeting between these two teams in 1912. Auburn leads the series 35-27-2. And Auburn has not won at Florida Field since 1972. The last meeting a year ago, Auburn picking up a 29-6 victory over Florida. And Lee, this has been a great rivalry throughout the years.
It's one of the best football teams in the country, but Auburn. There's Pat Dye. He started as a linebacker coach at Alabama for Bear Bryant, and now he's got his own football team at Auburn.
Of course, Pat spent years at East Carolina and 1 year in Wyoming as a head coach before coming to Auburn in his eighth season, and he has won better than 70% of his games. Meanwhile, Galen Hall was an assistant for many years at the University of Oklahoma, then came here as an assistant.
Yeah, he started his coaching career 2 years at West Virginia, which is a great football team now, and it went on 18 years at Oklahoma as an assistant.
And a sellout crowd here today at Florida Field. It is homecoming. And Florida has been very strong in their last 14 homecoming games. They are 13-1. And Lee, that's what homecoming's all about.
Yeah, but they have never played a football team as good as Auburn in those last 14 games.
Set to kick it off is John Francis. He's a good one. He's fourth in the nation in field goals for Florida. And back deep for Auburn will be number 18, and that's Alexander Wright. He's a junior from Albany, Georgia. And kickoff is going to be a short one, and Wright at the 5-yard line. And Wright up to the 25-yard line, and let's check out the offense for Auburn. Reggie Slack, 7 touchdown passes, is the quarterback. The running backs, James Joseph and Stacy Danley. The receivers, Freddie Weygand and Lawyer Tillman. He's been banged up lately. The tight end and a great blocker is Walter Reeves. Up front, the center is John Hudson. The guards are Ed King, a freshman, and Rodney Gardner. And the tackles, Jim Thompson and Rob Selby. As Auburn will take it first and 10 from the 25-yard line. About 3 yards, and let's check out the defense for the Gators of the University of Florida. Jeff Roth is the nose tackle. Trace Armstrong, Rondi Weston, they are strong up front with those three men. The inside backers, Pat Moore and Joey Nicoletto. On the outside, Owen Bartrip and Huey Richardson. The corners, Richard Fain and Kerry Watkins. And the safeties, Bill Lang and Watch 18, Lewis Oliver. He is a great one, 6'2", 222 pounds. Second and 7, a lot of pressure. Pass is deflected, but the man in there was Trace Armstrong, 93, a transfer from Arizona State University who was eligible this year because of a mix-up in his high school transcript, could play anywhere but ASU.
Absolutely. He's from Birmingham, Alabama, so you know this is a big game for him. As you see, comes to the outside, he beats number 76 Gardner to the outside. He's got enough speed to come and put the pressure on Slack from the blind side. Emotionally, big play for the Florida defense.
Trace Armstrong, 6'4", 268 pounds, 36 tackles, 3.5 sacks, and what a bonus for him to walk into your program as an experienced senior. Third down and 7. Motion is Taylor to the far side. Quick pitch goes to Stacy Danley. Tough running, but it's not going to be enough as he gets to the 34, and Jeff Roth, the middle guard from Seminole, Florida, the first man to hit him, and Auburn will have to punt it after their first possession.
On the replay, you watch number 78, Shelby. He gets a cut block, which means he cannot block Armstrong up around the shoulder, so he cuts him around the leg. Nice play by Shelby, number 78.
Brian Shulman, number 1, at the 19-yard line to punt it. And Tony Lomac back at his 20. And the punt will go out of bounds at the 22-yard line, where the Gators will have it first and 10, 44 yards on the punt. And let's set up the offense for Florida. Herbert Perry gets his second start of the year at quarterback. The running back, Cedric Smith, and Willie McClendon, a freshman from Jacksonville. The receivers, Willie Snead and Tony Lomac. The tight end is Mark McGriff. Up front, Tracy Daniels is the center. The guards, Brad Hatcher and Hisham Ismail. The tackles, David William, he's their best offensive lineman, and John Durden. As Florida, their first possession from the 22-yard line, and a lot of movement. You're going to see a lot of players and a lot of action from their offense today. Play action as Perry tried to find Cedric Smith, and he was dumped in the backfield. Let's take a look at the defense for Auburn. Benji Rowland is the nose guard. Tracy Rocker and Ron Stallworth, the defensive tackles. Rocker is a great one. Quentin Riggins, their leading tackler, and Smokey Hodge, the inside backers. On the outside, Brian Smith and Craig Ogletree, their leading sack man. In the secondary, Carlo Cheetah and John Wiley, the corners. And the safeties, Greg Staples and Shan Morris, who picked off 3 passes in 1 game earlier this year. Second and 10. They'll run an H-back as Darrell Woolard moves up in the slot on the near side. Now he goes in motion to the far side. Woolard comes out throwing, and the intended receiver was Willie Snead. Carlo Cheatham, 35, was on the coverage.
Well, that's kind of a questionable call to start off a quarterback throwing the ball twice, once on a bootleg, but that pass in particular is a very difficult pass to throw from one hash mark to the other. But at least Florida has come out and tried to move the ball, tried to score, and trying to keep the Auburn defense on the defense.
Perry, 6'2", 204-pound sophomore, as we mentioned, just his second start of the year. Lomac and McGriff split out to the near side on 3rd and 10. A lot of time, and the receiver was there, Willie Snead. Quentin Riggins was on the coverage, and that'll bring up a punting situation for the University of Florida.
Auburn brought an inside linebacker. If you see Rocker, number 74, he rushes to the outside on number 72, Durden, who gets pretty good protection. But in the inside, the middle linebacker is the one that caused that pass to go astray.
Fernando Acosta-Rua, the punter from Jacksonville, and back to Shane Wasden at the 38-yard line. Rua averaging just over 39 yards a punt, and Wasden across midfield to the 47, and Auburn will have great field position, 35 yards on the punt, 11 yards on the return, 13 to go, first quarter.
Is being brought to you by Jeep. There's a feeling you can get only in a Jeep. By Budweiser, Beechwood Age for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by the Remington Electro Blade Razor, the vibrating blade system. Homecoming Saturday in Gainesville, Florida. Roger Twyba, Lee Corso with you. As Auburn with great field position, you got to wonder, is this going to be a defensive struggle? 6 of the last 9 meetings between these two teams decided by a touchdown or less. Auburn, 1st and 10 from the 47-yard line.
inside the 45 to the 43-yard line where Pat Moore made the tackle. And coming up tomorrow night here on ESPN, we get back to our NFL coverage, the Washington Redskins and the Houston Oilers, live at 8 Eastern time as NFL football comes back to fill out your football weekend here on ESPN. Second down and 4. Call it a 6-yard pickup. And they'll pound it again. That's James Joseph. That's enough for the first down at the 35-yard line where Bill Lang, the 50-year strong safety from Castleberry, Florida, makes the stop. Look at this. The only Auburn running back to gain 100-plus yards this season. As a matter of fact, since Brent Fullwood in 86, Auburn's only had 4 ball carriers rush for 100 yards in a game, and Joseph's has 2 of those games.
That's when Auburn changed with Pat Sullivan coming in, and they've emphasized the pass a little bit more. But they're not going to pass the ball anymore. They're going to try to test Florida right at them right now.
First and 10 as they give it to Danley, and he's stacked up right at the line of scrimmage. 4 orange shirts led by 96 Jeff Roth, who came into this game with 34 tackles on the year.
Roth is a first-team All-SEC. If you watch the middle of your picture, he gets away from the center 66. He plays his position, which means he did not over-pursue, and the ball carrier ran right into him. Good play by Roth.
Second down and 10. Freddie Wagans puts to the near side. He's a fifth-year senior. Deflected, intended for James Joseph. Huey Richardson, number 90, the outside backer, 6'5", 233, a sophomore from Atlanta, cousin of Al Richardson, who plays for the Falcons.
Well, they think he's going to be a superstar. The bottom right-hand side of your picture, watch number 90, Richardson, rushing the passer, puts up his hand and knocks it down. He's going against number 54, Jim Thompson, the best offensive lineman that Auburn has.
These are two of the very best defensive teams in the country. They rank second and third in different categories. They're both very strong against the run, and they also have great athletes in the secondary. On third down and 10 from the 35. Slack. Sack. Trace Armstrong, 93. Make it 4.5 sacks this year.
It's obviously 93. Armstrong is really up for this ball game. He's going to rush from the left-hand side of your picture. He looks like he's too quick for 78 Shelby. He's got good athletic ability. He never gives up, and that's the sign of a great defensive lineman.
Brian Shulman at his 46-yard line. And a fair catch call by Terrence Barber at the 7. That time he did the right thing inside the 10-yard line because great coverage. Auburn and Florida scoreless in the first quarter. Second possession for the Florida Gators. Lee, first time, 3 passes and a punt. First and 10. They run it right up the middle. Cedric Smith, 39, the junior from Enterprise, Alabama. And this is the injury report. Out 2 to 4 weeks, Emmett Smith, Ernie Mills, Todd Gavlin, Wayne Williams. Out for the season, Stacy Simmons, Clifton Reynolds, and Harvey Thomas. Simmons is a big one. He was their leader on and off the field. And, of course, they missed Smith and they missed Williams in the backfield.
Smith said, told us yesterday, he'll be ready for the Bulldogs in Jacksonville next week.
Would you have played him today?
Absolutely not. His future is more important than winning the Auburn game.
Second and 8. 10:21 to go, first quarter. Kirkpatrick in motion to the near side, and they'll run it this way with Willie McClendon, who one of these days is going to be a great running back. He's just a freshman from Jacksonville, probably the highest recruited running back in the state of Florida a year ago.
University Christian High School in Jacksonville, but this is a little bit too soon for him. They did not want to play him. They wanted to back up Smith with McClendon, but he's going to be a great player eventually.
Pat Dye, the head coach at Auburn, who said, this game will decide whether we're a great team or not. Third down and 8. Willie Snead split to the near side. And they'll run it again. So interesting calls as Willie McClendon goes nowhere. The first series, 3 passes and a punt. Second series, 3 runs and a punt.
The reason why is because the field position was horrible. The great punt by Schubert put it in there. The defense is too strong to run against, but Florida also knows if you'll watch the defense from Auburn, they're awful strong. 96, rolling strong. They're all in there tough. 95 is the little rocker, David.
Acosta Rua in his own end zone. The punt to Shane Wasden, who's at midfield. That's going to be another short punt. Wasden, a fair catch, and so Auburn with great field position again at the 42-yard line, 33 yards in the punt. Let's go to Tim Brando. Tim?
Roger, how's it going for a numero uno in Pasadena? Well, let's show you. Troy Aikman with a little play-action fake up the middle to Eric Ball. And then the touchdown pass to Danny Thompson, and the Bruins of UCLA now lead the Cougars of Washington State 20-3. Let's get back to Florida Field, Rod.
Thank you, Tim. We'll keep you updated on all the college scores here. Our first of two today, Auburn in Florida, and the Tigers at 8:57 to go. Now the first and 10 at the 42 of the Gators. Joseph. He's at the 40-yard line, a gain of a couple. Bill Lang, 24, who's been in on 41 tackles this year. And this is an adjusted offensive backfield for Auburn, Lee.
Yes, Joseph, number 10, is usually the fullback. Sometimes he's the tailback. And Danley, number 32. Both of those people are outstanding players, but they're both young. They're both second-year players for Auburn.
One lone setback this time. That's James Joseph. That's Alex Strong. In the slot to the near side on second and 9. Slack intercepted. Intercepted by 18, Lewis Oliver. And he's across the 40 to the 42, the second pick of the year by the senior from Belgrade, Florida.
Lewis Oliver is a great football player. He's an All-American. And this time, you'll watch the quarterback's eyes. Slack goes back to pass. He's trying to hit Royer, turned around the middle, but you watch 18. You see 18? It's called free safety. Free safety means he has the ability to roam anywhere in the middle of the field, watch the quarterback's eyes, just like he did there, and intercept the football.
Florida leads the Southeastern Conference with 13 interceptions now. Auburn has 11, and the chess match. Maybe Stephen Wright knew what he was talking about before the game, because this is beginning to become a chess match. No score, 8:15 left to go, first quarter. Florida puts it on the ground again, and Willie McClendon's got nowhere to go. Boy, a host of Auburn players on top of him that time. 48, Alvin Mitchell, a backup outside linebacker, one of the men in on the stop, and also Quentin Riggins, and there's a look at Lewis Oliver. This is a true walk-on. They even said, don't come here when he asked them about coming. He had a couple of scholarships offers to small schools, and he has made himself into a great, great player. One of the things about Oliver, 4.3 speed in the 40, a 33.5-inch vertical leap. He is a Jim Thorpe candidate for outstanding defensive back in the nation. Second and 11. Pass. Is it good? Yes. Caught by Tony Lomax. At the 48-yard line, Smokey Hodge on the coverage. It wasn't thrown very well, but Lomax with a nice grab.
But I also like the call. That time it was a nice little button hook. Lomax went down, found the open spot. Perry, all he had to do was throw it straight. Much better than the first three passes they called from the sideline because they were more difficult passes.
Neither of these teams, Lee, have allowed a touchdown in the first quarter this year, and Auburn has not allowed a touchdown in the first half. Third down and one. McClendon across midfield in the first down at the Auburn 48-yard line. Over knocking him out, Carlo Cheatham and Quentin Riggins, number 41, the junior from Montgomery.
Good call. Nice little toss play. They don't have enough power to go inside, so they go to the outside with a good block by McGriff, number 80. McClendon shows why he was a highly recruited athlete at 214 pounds. First down, Florida. Now they're on the other side of the 50. They are now winning the ball game.
We should know, too, that Florida has a bit of a makeshift offensive line. They've got some tackles playing guard. We got some backups in there as McClendon takes it. And tries to go outside, and Quentin Riggins was all over him. Riggins, number 41, and Benji Rova, 96, throwing for a 3-yard loss back to the Florida 49-yard line.
Pat Dye knows this is going to be a tough defensive ball game, but this is the kind of plays he likes. Number 41, Riggins, to the inside. He's the linebacker that scrapes, which means he watches, and then he attacks behind the line of scrimmage. Quentin Riggins, 5'11", 210-pound junior from Montgomery, Alabama.
6:12 to go, first quarter. That'll bring a second down and 13 as McGriff moves into the slot on the near side. And Kirkpatrick in motion. Well thrown ball. Womack has it, and he's down at the 33-yard line. Shan Morris made the stop, 19 yards on the reception, and he showed a good arm that time, Lee.
I tell you what I liked about Curry that time, he stayed in the pocket with number 94 coming after him from the outside. If you see this picture from the top of your picture, you'll see an outside linebacker trying to come and get him over Tree, but he steps up and throws the ball beautifully to Lomac. First down Gators, and they're now, they're taking the play away from the Auburn Tigers.
Florida will use three tight ends on many occasions, a lot of motion. Perry has completed 59% of his passes coming into the game. No touchdowns, three interceptions, his second start of the year. First and 10, they'll give it to McClendon. And he is grabbed at the 33-yard line. It looked like momentarily he was stripped of the football. Ogletree 94 and Roland 96 says, I'll tell you, Benji Roland has shown you some very good lateral pursuits so far.
Roland, 96, 74 rocker, 92 star, with the three best defensive linemen in America. Bar none, they can play against anybody. You notice how when Florida runs the I formation and they run the ball to the toss, play to the tailback, there are about eight guys around there. Auburn's a well-coached football team defensively.
They're going to give McClendon a pickup of one on that play. That'll make it second and nine as Lomax splits to the near side. They've got that H-back, the tight end Kirkpatrick, who's in the slot to the right. And a penalty marker is down. A penalty marker against Florida.
Dead ball foul, movement by a lineman before the snap. 5 yard penalty, still second down.
Last year at this time, Florida had been whistled for 52 penalties worth 490 yards. That a year ago. This year coming into the game, 57 penalties, 556 yards, 15 personal fouls, though, 10 after the ball was blown dead. So that either means their defense is awfully aggressive or they're teaching them to be a little bit more aggressive. Second down and 14. That's Kirkpatrick in motion to the far side. Good protection, deflected, 96, Benji Roland dropped back off the line of scrimmage. He was back in the coverage, and he knocked it down.
Tracy Rocker, number 74, is one of the finest players in America, but if you can't block him with one, you block him with two. There's a nice block in there by the right guard, Ismail, and then they pick him up with number 63, Daniel. Rocker is going to have a tough time with two men on him, but if there's two on him, there can't be but one on Stallworth or Roland, and they'll cut him from the other side.
Rocker is the only returning Lombardi finalist from a year ago, as Perry is 2 of 6 for 28 yards, and he's got a third down and 14 now. Ball is deflected, but Perry picks it back up. He's saying go deep, and he is nailed again. I want to tell you about a play that was just made by Craig Ogletree, 94, because he came in, he stripped the ball away from Perry. Perry picked it back up. Ogletree then went after him and dumped him and caused that pass to go incomplete.
Ogletree is 6'2", 226. He's a leading sacker. Comes to the left-hand side of your picture. Knocks the ball down. But watch Ogletree. Not only does he knock the ball down, he'll get up as Roger called it and try to catch Perry from the backside. Great play by Ogletree, number 94.
Into punt is number 10, Hank Rose, for Florida. And the Gators in the air grab it at the 5-yard line.
Rocker number 75, the All-American, is going to get a shot at him by number 77, Ismail. But number 63, Daniel, who is outweighed 25 pounds, stays in front of Rocker and does a good job. Right now, they're putting two men on Rocker. They might have to put three before the game's over. He's a great football player.
And Reggie Slack, the Auburn quarterback, has not completed a pass yet. He's 0 for 3. First and 10 from the 5-yard line. They'll run it right up the middle. James Joseph with a gain of about 4. And Huey Richardson, the tackle. As we check out some scores for you, Penn has beaten Princeton this afternoon. Yale over Dartmouth. Harvard over Brown as Harvard gets off the schneid. Lehigh big over Columbia. And Cornell and Lafayette play to a 21 tie. Bucknell over Davidson, 21-13. And Holy Cross against the Gate. They win it 7-0. Second and five, 3:28 to go. First quarter from Gainesville, Florida. Again, it's Joseph. And he's across the 10 to about the 12-yard line. Pat Moore, 45, and Lewis Oliver, the free safety. You know, Oliver, with such great speed, he runs on the Florida 4x200 relay team, and they have the best indoor time in 1988. 1:26 and 31 100s. He teams up with Stacy Simmons, Tony James, and Ed Frazier. A tremendous athlete. Third down and two for Oliver. Joseph, as Rondi Weston, the senior from Belleville, Florida, gets him behind the line of scrimmage.
Auburn went to their favorite play, a toss play this time, but number 68, Weston, makes a great play on the right-hand side of your picture. He'll come to the inside. He'll beat Thompson 54 to the inside, and he's strong enough to take the 200-pound back like Joseph and just throw him back. Great play by Weston, 68.
Shulman averaging over 40 yards a punt this year. Hits a nice spiraling kick that Terrence Barber will take. A bit of a jitterbug across midfield to the 46-yard line. 44 yards on the punt, 6 on the return. Tim Garner on the special teams for Auburn. And there's Albert, the Alligator. How about SEC and the nation scoring defense? Well, Auburn 1, Florida 3. Alabama 10, LSU 10, and Kentucky 39.
Roger, that all started with a gentleman by the name of Bob Nealon, Tennessee. They emphasized the good defense, the kicking game. Bear Bryant came in, and it's always been the same in the SEC. Great defense and tremendous kicking game.
Three wide receivers now for the Gators. One lone setback. First and 10 with 2:09 to go. Kirkpatrick in motion. Terry crossed the middle, and he's got his man at the 41-yard line. That was Lomack.
Lomack, number 20, will go down the field, and he breaks what they call an underneath cut. They'll drive two men deep, and as he comes underneath, he gets single coverage and makes a good catch. I like the way the Florida receivers are reaching out and catching the ball with their hands. Excellent coaching by the Florida receiver coach.
Anthony Judge, 59, the man who made the tackle, 7 yards on the pickup. Second down and three with 1:30 left to go. First quarter, no score, and they pounded right up the middle that time, and driving ahead for yardage. Number 21, Dexter McNabb, who just checked into the game, a freshman from Dufuriac Springs, and Benji Rowland, who's been on at least a half dozen tackles so far, as the Florida defense. And Joey Micheletto there, 49. A lot of fifth-year seniors on this team, a lot of experience, too, on the Florida, especially the defensive side.
Third down and short yardage. The last time Florida had this situation, they ran a toss play to the right to the short field and made the first down. Let's see if they do it again.
Third down and one, and Herbert Perry will call a timeout. So with 51 seconds left to go, first quarter, and on a third down and one, Perry, who's making just his second start this year, will take it to the sidelines and talk to head coach Galen Hall. Lynn Amity is their offensive coordinator, came over from Texas A&M this year.
Lynn Amity is a great offensive football coach. As you said, he came over from Texas A&M. It's interesting that Amity, after the 1965-66 Cotton Bowl, Pat Dye was so impressed with Lynn Amity's coaching at A&M, he invited him to Auburn for 4 days, and that's why Auburn and Florida looked like they run the same offense.
Obviously, Amity, if he'd have known at that time he was going to go work at Florida, he would have never given him the offense, right?
Amity is the gentleman with his left hand on his face right there. He's the gentleman talking to Perry right now with his left hand pointing that way. Outstanding football coach. Galen Hall is smart enough to know when you got a great football coach like in Amity, you talk it over right there, and you come up with a consensus.
Now, they've had some injuries at quarterback. Lex Smith has been hurt. Kyle Morris has had some problems. What about the future for Florida quarterback?
They say number 12, Lex Smith, a redshirt quarterback, could be one of the best quarterbacks they've had here since Steve Spurrier. That's quite a compliment.
Yeah. Perry, 3 of 8 for 35 yards, third and one. McClendon, he's got a great second effort by the freshman from Jacksonville. Steve Brown, 38, made the tackle. But Florida with the first down.
You got to like the call. They went right at him, man on man, the left side. They went right after him with number 76, Hatcher, and number 73, Williams, and McClendon makes a good run. Notice the first time they went around the right end, this time they went inside. Good block by 39, Cedric Smith, first down, Florida Gators.
All right, Williams, 73, was blowing people out, too. First and 10 now. 27 seconds left to go. McClendon breaks one tackle, but not for long, as 94, Craig Ogletree makes the stop. Let's go to Tim Brando. Tim?
Roger, a wild one in the Southwest Conference. And remember, Coach McWilliams at Texas used to be at Texas Tech. 32-33, Travis Price, the two-point conversion. They had trailed 32-15. The Red Raiders come from behind late to win it there in the Southwest Conference. So a bit of a surprise in the Southwest. Let's get back to Roger and Lee.
Okay, thanks, Tim. And we've completed the first quarter of play here at Gainesville, Florida. Auburn, Florida, scoreless. We'll be back in just a moment. Millions of You're looking at the leading rusher in the Southeastern Conference, and he missed a conference game against Vanderbilt. That's Emmitt Smith. And one of these days, you got to figure he's got a future in the NFL, because Sunday, I'm sure he'll be watching here on ESPN, the Redskins and the Oilers. And I thought I saw Lee Corso on a sign there.
It's probably my son telling me to send money. Probably came over last night from Florida State to see the Gator Growl.
You know, in 83, the game between these two teams, Auburn and Florida, produced 51 players that went on to play in the National Football League. 51 out of that game. The likes of Bo Jackson and Lionel James from Auburn, Lorenzo Hampton and Wilbur Marshall from Florida. Well, they've had some great talent here.
It's interesting that Pat Dye yesterday told us that maybe the 1984 Florida team might have been the best football team he ever coached against. That's quite a compliment.
Second down and 13. We start the second quarter from Gainesville, Florida. McGriff goes over to the far side. And that's Darrell Woolard in motion. Penalty markers down as Terrence Barber makes the catch, and they don't fool anybody. John Wiley, number 9, was right there to stop him. And he also got some help from Ron Stallworth. This has been a rather penalty-free game so far. Just one flag that I can remember.
Both of these teams have been penalized quite a bit. In fact, I think they're 1-2 in the SEC when it comes to penalties.
There's Galen
Back
Hall.
Back in motion toward the line of scrimmage at the snap. It declined. Be third down.
And Auburn will decline that penalty. Back in motion.
It's third down and long yardage. They've got to be very, very careful here not to turn the ball over, because if they do nothing else but just punt it, they're still got Auburn backed up and they can play great defense.
See the total yards, Auburn none passing. Florida 35, Auburn 23-6 on the rushing side. It is third down and 17. They have four wide receivers right now. Perry is dunked. 96, Benji Rowland got a piece of it. He was able to throw the pass, but Woolard never had a chance to catch it.
96, Rowland just coming to the inside. Now they're double-teaming number 74, Rocker. If they double-team number 74, they can only put one on 96, Rowland. That's why Rowland put the pressure to quarterback.
Now Galen Hall has either changed punters or he's just using Hank Rose on the short punts, because Rose is at the 45-yard line, and he'll kick it down to Shane Wasden. Spiraling kick that's angling to the near side, and they're going to say it's down at the 4-yard line. Well, I don't know if Lee Corso says go Gators or not, but we're enjoying ourselves again. Americans have made much better a long distance company can be, and by Atra Plus, Gillette made it smoother. Toronto, Lee Corso, along with you at homecoming Saturday in Gainesville, Florida. No score. 14-20 left to go, first half. And Auburn has it, first and 10 from the 20-yard line, where they came back to mark it after that punt. They'll run it right up the middle. James Joseph, a gain of about 3. Jeff Roth, the middle guard, the senior from Seminole, Florida, 6'4", 253. Joseph now 7 carries for 20 yards, and he's a sophomore from Phenix City, Alabama. You know, they've got quite a number of guys from the state of Florida, 16 players from the state of Florida, as we take a look at the Florida sideline, and Kyle Morris, number one, is warming up on the sideline. So Lynn Amity told us yesterday we could see both those quarterbacks today. It looks like it might happen. On second down, the completion, the number 86, Walter Reeves, the tight end, and he's going to be very close to the first down as Pat Moore makes a stop. Reeves is a tremendous blocking tight end. What do you look for in a tight end, Lee?
We look, first of all, if you're at Auburn, you look for a blocker like he is because they're a running team. But if you're at other schools, you look for a guy that's a little bit less a blocker but more of an open pass receiver.
I'll tell you, the NFL love Reeves the way he blocks.
Right.
That was a first down. First and 10. Joseph in motion to the near side. So Slack, after missing his first 4 passes, has completed 2 in a row. That goes to Joseph. And Pat Moore, once again on the tackle at the 35, a gain of about 5.
You notice that Pat Sullivan's starting to call passing game plays that he can complete. The tight end is hooking in the middle, but they're putting 2 men on number 45 Moore. If he takes number 86 Reeves, he throws the ball to number 10, Joseph. Good conception right there.
I think it's interesting, though, too. They gave Slack a couple nice, easy passes to the backs, and they don't usually throw to their backs in the Auburn scheme of things. Second down and 5, they'll run it with Joseph. Boy, he battles to the 45-yard line where Bill Lang and Lewis Oliver finally make the tackle, a 10-yard pickup, and Auburn's got a first down.
You got to like the way number 78, Shelby, 76, Gardner, come off the ball and knock him down, number 70, Meeks. But you also like number 67, King, a freshman pulling from the left side. Now watch him block right there on number 45, Moore. Outstanding play, 67, the left guard, King.
And he's a true freshman, 6'4 and 270 from Phenix City, Alabama. First and 10, Auburn at the 45. Alex Strong pushed the left side for about a 4-yard gain. Jeff Roth makes the tackle. As we check out some other scores at halftime, UCLA leads Washington State. USC over Oregon State in the second, 17-7. Nebraska leads Missouri by 2 in the fourth quarter. Oklahoma, 49. Kansas, 14 in the fourth. And Oklahoma State in the fourth quarter with a lead over Kansas State. Alabama leading Mississippi State in the fourth. Arizona State and Oregon tied up at 14 in the second. And we'll keep you updated throughout the afternoon on second and 6. Nice reception over there by Stacy Danley. Kerry Watkins was there on the coverage. That's going to be just short of a first down at the Florida 46-yard line.
From ground level, we'll take a look at 93 Armstrong. Very quick. Notice number 70, Meeks, gets good position on him, tries to hold him, but number 93 Armstrong never gives up. Good play, though, by Meeks, number 70, to stay in front of Armstrong.
Third down and 2. Joseph, first down inside the 45 to the 43-yard line. He went behind the right side of Rodney Gardner and Rob Selby, 76 and 78 respectively. Joey Nicoletto, 49, and Kerry Watkins on the tackle.
Keep your eye on number 67, King pulling. There's a major league football play right there. Not only does he pull, he gets a good football position and just runs right over number 45 Moore.
And you know when the coaches look at the film and they see a defensive man on his back from a block, that's great and 100% right there. First and 10. Danley inside the 40 for the 38-yard line. Kerry Watkins and Lewis Oliver. And Auburn now putting together a good solid drive. This began at their own 20-yard line.
Now they're starting to attack number 93 Armstrong right at him. In fact, one of the best ways to attack a great football player is right at him, then option running. Notice number 70 Meeks just took him the way he wanted to go. And number 32 Danley option run, which meant he broke it into the inside.
Second down and 5 with 10:24 to go. First half. Slack checking off at the line of scrimmage. Alex Strong, he'll get down near the 35-yard line where Rondi Weston, 68, the right tackle, came into the game with 24 tackles. As Pat Dye, the Auburn head coach, said in the loss to LSU, as he was telling us yesterday, he felt that maybe they threw the ball a little too much, Lee.
Obviously, Look what they're doing now. They're going to run it. The gentleman in the orange coat there is Pat Sullivan, the former Heisman Trophy winner, who signals in the plays from the sideline.
And Pat Sullivan led Auburn to a 63-14 homecoming win here at Florida in 1970. Third down and three. First down inside the 30th, Stacy Danley. Huey Richardson finally brought him down, but Danley at 6'3 and 206 was a good power running.
Strong runner. Watch number 76 and right-hand side of your picture will come into picture. Right there, that's Gardner. That's the reason why the play is going good. The offside guards are pulling and leading through the hole. Very, very sound theory.
Auburn now has used up nearly 6 minutes of the second quarter. They've got it first and 10 at the 30-yard line. And run it again to Stacy Danley, and he just runs right over Lewis Oliver inside the 25 to the 24-yard line. Jerry Odom, I don't know, do you coaches call that making a tackle when he runs over a guy that falls over?
It's better to let him run over you and run for a touchdown. But what they're doing now, why this plays are going so good, is they've got Oliver hurt right there because Danley took him on with his shoulder. But the reason why these plays are going so well, the Auburn line is exploding into the Florida man, and they're pulling an offside guard. They're outnumbering Florida at the point of attack.
Second down and four. They go to Alex Strong. Strong gets maybe 2 yards on that play. Trace Armstrong and Huey Richardson on the tackle. So Oliver has left the game because he took Danley on head on, and he lost that battle. So Alex Strong coming off. Roger Twyba, Lee Corso with you. Gainesville, Florida, 8:13 to go. First half, Auburn in Florida with no score. It's third down and three on this drive that started at the Auburn 20-yard line. James Joseph. Nice play out on the wing. 26 for Florida. Came up to make the stop. And we've got a number change, but we'll find out who it is.
Okay, it might be 28 Fade, the right corner, coming up on Joseph. If he does, he's smart. He blocks him, knocks him down low.
You're right.
You know what? He saw his buddy Oliver get creamed. He decided to cut him underneath by the legs.
Field goal attempt now. Wynn Lyle. It'll be a 40-yard attempt. And it's good. So Lyle, who came into the game, one of three from 40-plus yards, hits his second from that distance. And Auburn takes a 3-0 lead over Florida. Chris Johnson takes it off, and Lomax going to run it out of the end zone, and he is nailed at the 14-yard line. Domingo Anderson was the man that came down to make the stop. 13 plays, 57 yards, time of possession, 7 minutes and 1 second, and Lyle, the 40-yard field goal.
One of the things the kickoff coverage team does is they try to get the ball of the offense inside the 20. This is such a great job by Anderson, 13. They got the ball on the 14. That's a tremendous play by the kickoff coverage team by Auburn.
Florida now with their new quarterback in. That's Kyle Morris, a freshman from Clinton, Mississippi, as he started the majority of games for the Gators this year. And McClendon gets to the line of scrimmage, and not much more than that. Anthony Judge, the freshman from Fort Lauderdale, came up to make the stop. I was going to mention, they've got 16 players from the state of Florida, and Morris with the plays on his left wrist.
If you'll notice the toss play here, McClendon will run to the right, but I want you to count the number of white jerseys. 59 smacks them right there, but watch, there's at least 7 white jerseys around him. That's what I talked about in the pregame show, intimidation of the Florida offense.
McClendon and Smith are the running backs on second down and 11. Morris felt the pressure, throws it downfield, and nearly completed. Willie Sneed was the intended receiver. There is a penalty marker down. Shan Morris, the senior from Atlanta. You might remember his dad that played with the Chicago Bears for a number of years, Jim Morris.
defensive pass interference, a spot foul will be first down for the offense.
So it'll be a first down at the spot.
If you'll notice, number 20, Morris here, he's going for the ball. Number 9, Steed's got good position. Number 20 hits him right there with his left hand before the ball will get there. We got it from another angle, and you'll see it even better this way. The quarterback is trying to scramble, Morris is. He throws the ball on the run. Watch right there. You see it? Perfect play by the camera work to show number 20 on pass interference.
First and 10, Smith, the lone setback. And he'll get the football as they try to run the left side, and he is smothered. 95, David Rocker, the younger brother of Tracy Rocker, into the stop. David, 95, plays behind Tracy, 74. And they don't lose much putting little brother in there.
Little brother could be one of the next great linemen that Auburn has ever had, especially the fact that he's got something to point for. When he sees his brother Tracy do well, makes him even better.
Play selection, Auburn, 20 rushes, 6 passes. Florida pretty even, 12 and 11. Second and 9. Kirkpatrick in motion. Oh, nearly intercepted. Nearly intercepted by Quentin Riggins, number 41. And let's go to Tim Brando. Tim?
Roger, the records keep falling in Norman. Jamel Holloway breaking another record here with a 22-yard touchdown pass to Artie Guest. 49 unanswered points for the Sooners against Kansas now. And for Holloway, 4,848 yards, the all-time offensive leader in total yards. Let's get back to Roger and Lee.
Okay, looks like the Sooners throwing a little late in that game. 5:46 left to go. First half, 3rd and 9. Morris has 2 men. And that is intercepted. Shan Morris with his 4th interception of the year on the deflected pass.
Morris, number 20 from Atlanta, Georgia. If you notice, he's back in the deep position. Number 20 is going across the middle. Lomax, the ball is deflected, and Morris dives for the ball right here and gets it. Morris not only intercepted 3 passes against Mississippi State last week, he did it in the second quarter. That's a career for some people.
I said Jim Larry Morris is his dad. You're supposed to correct me on those things, Lee. Stacy Danley, first down at the 37-yard line. Kerry Watkins finally makes a stop.
The Florida line is getting tired, but those offensive backs, number 32, Danley, are not getting tired. He runs right through number 49, Micheletto, and drives himself forward. The game is being won up front right now by the offensive line of Auburn.
First and 10, 5:20 to go. First half, Danley again, and Danley just running over people. Now, Florida will substitute a lot, both offensively and defensively. It's been rather hot down here in the mid-80s, but today there's a nice breeze coming through as Danley, 8 rushes and 39 yards. But the break Auburn was looking for was that interception, because we thought it would be a defensive battle and possibly the kicking game and turnovers the deciding factor. And let's see what Auburn can do now on 2nd and 6 with less than 5 minutes to go. First half. Joseph off the left side, inside the 30 to the 29. It'll be just shy on the first down. Bill Lang, the strong safety, a fifth-year senior who came into this game with the most tackles of anyone in the secondary with 41, gets credited for that one.
Joseph's made a nice run there, but I tell you what, number 32, Danley, from Winston, Georgia, just cleaned the linebacker out, and that's the reason why Auburn's moving the football. Not only the line, but those backs are blocking each other.
Down and 2. Stacy Danley, first down offer. Huey Richardson made the tackle, and Danley's good-looking running back, 6'3", 206.
Now this time they got strong in there, 6'2", 222. He gets a great block on number 44, Bartley. Again, I mention it, the line can do the blocking, but boy, those backs have got to block for each other, and that's what makes Auburn a great football team.
Danley, 9 carries, 43 yards, 1st and 10. Auburn, a little trouble at the offensive line as Florida was showing some blitz that time, and it appeared as though it confused the offensive line, and consequently, Danley stopped behind the line of scrimmage by Huey Richardson. Pat Dye, who, while coaching Auburn, has won two Southeastern Conference titles in 83 and 87. Both times, though, he had to beat Florida and Georgia to get those titles. Second and 11. Slack, a lot of pressure, penalty markers down, and Slack is sacked by Huey Richardson.
Sacked by Richardson, back in the game.
That could have been any of those three front men. It could have been Armstrong. It could have been Roth. It could have been Rondy Weston. They were all there, but Huey Richardson, the leading sack man on Florida from his outside linebacker spot, finally brought Slack down.
If you notice, that's Galen Hall with the orange hat. He's lost over 30 pounds since last year. He's been on a diet, and he looks wonderful. He was a little heavy last year.
Is that what some losses will do to you during the offseason?
At holding by the offensive lineman on the play, they're taking the penalty. He's second down again.
You take a look at number 76 in there, Gardner, 78, Shelby. Number 78, Shelby, could be the man, but it could have been any one of those three guys. It looked like, actually, all three offensive linemen were holding.
So Galen Hall, oh, there's a lot of different ways to lose weight. I imagine the coaching ranks, disgruntled fans, alumni pressure, all that sort of stuff is a cause sometimes. Second down and 21 with 2:45 to go. First half. Slack under pressure again, but he gets away. Not for long as Rondy Weston runs him down at the 45-yard line. Fourth sack of the year for Weston. 6'5 and 278 from Belgrade, Florida.
First team all Southeastern Conference, the right hand side of your picture. Number 68 gets away from number 54, Thompson. And look at the speed. He actually outruns 17 Slack to the corner. What a tremendous defensive play. If you watch him from the right hand side of your picture, he can outrun the Auburn quarterback.
Third down now and 31 with less than 2 minutes to go. First half. Auburn leads Florida 3-0, and the Tigers want a timeout. Get the Corso back with you at Florida Field in Gainesville. 1:55 to go, first half. Third down and 31 for Auburn. Taylor in motion to the far side. Slack move. Boy, I'll tell you what. That was intended for Taylor, but Bill Lang was right in that area. Could have been picked off. And now Auburn has got a punt at Florida's got two timeouts left to go. And the Gators might get pretty good field position, and it looked like Auburn was going to go in maybe for a TD, but at least for three.
But Auburn made a smart call that time from the sideline. They threw the ball out of bounds. If you can't complete the ball, throw it out of bounds. At least they didn't have it intercepted like they did the one that went across the middle with Oliver.
Shulman has eight times this year kicked it inside the 24, inside the 10-yard line, as Florida let that go, and that's going to be down deep in Gator territory. So for the fifth time this year, Brian Shulman has done a good job. And as a matter of fact, four of his punts have led directly to Auburn scores this year, as Shulman's credited with 39 yards on that punt. And coming up later tonight here on ESPN, I want you to stay with us because 17th-ranked South Carolina will take on North Carolina State. Of course, an off week for the Gamecocks, and of course, a lot of controversy with that big story on steroids you saw today on our game day report with Tim Brando, an interview with Joe Morrison. So can South Carolina bounce back from the defeat at the hands of Georgia Tech and some devastating news about players in their program? That's coming up later tonight after our game here on ESPN. First and 10. Now Perry is back in at quarterback. McClendon, I'll tell you what, Lee, he had that ball hanging out in one hand right there at the 5-yard line as he gets nothing.
Now, you're going to hear a lot of boos from the fans because they want Florida to throw the ball. But you know what? So does Auburn want Florida to throw the ball. It would be psychologically an advantage right now for Florida just to run the clock out and go behind into the halftime only 3-0.
I'm kind of surprised Auburn, who has a couple timeouts, is not using any right here.
Especially if they have a chance to block a punt and at least get a safety or maybe.
Well, they've got two. Maybe they will after the second down play. Second and 13. That's a delay. McClendon, and he's dropped at the 3-yard line. Alvin Mitchell, 48. And now Auburn will take the timeout. A good call with 48 seconds left to go, first half.
Mitchell, 48, is a fine football player. As he comes from the other side of your picture, you're going to watch him as a counteraction. Number 5 starts one way, McClendon does, but on your right-hand side of your picture right there, number 48 drops him down. A timeout. That's important.
Roger Twyba, Lee Corso back with you in Florida, and their coach Galen Hall faced with a third down and 15 at their own 3-yard line. McClendon came into this game averaging nearly 5 yards a carry, 11 rushes for minus 5 yards for the freshman as he gets it again and gets them out to about the 7-yard line, and Auburn calls a timeout with 43 seconds left to go first half. Quentin Riggins, 41, down at the bottom of the pile, making the tackle for the Tigers of Auburn.
The reason Auburn called timeout here is so they can try to block the punt. It's an ISO play. Good call. It's a safe play. You're not going to make the first down, but he's got at least protects the ball, and he's swammed under. Now, the big thing here is, you know that if by chance Auburn doesn't block the punt, the gentleman can call for a fair catch, and they can get a free kick, and they could kick a field goal on the next play. Do you know that?
Good point. I always learn something new with you every week.
No, but that's, I've seen that done.
I'm serious.
If the Florida kicker kicks it to about the 25-yard line and you signal for a fair catch, you get a free kick for a field goal. And that'd be better than, be 6-0. That would be better than 3.
Shane Wasden is back, and that's Fernando Acosta-Rua, junior from Jacksonville, averaging just under 40 yards a punt. Wasden at the 42-yard line. And 43 seconds left to go. First half, and you can see 36 and 32 yards for Acosta-Rua. 9 men up on the line of scrimmage for Auburn. And Wasden, the fair catch at the 37-yard line, a punt of just 30 yards. So with 35 seconds left to go in the first half, Auburn has no timeouts remaining. But they can certainly get themselves in field goal position.
And there's one man we haven't called his name all day. Number 85, Royer Tillman. And if I was the Auburn coach, I'd send Tillman down the middle and I'd throw it to him and let him out jump everybody in the end zone.
Well, we haven't called Wigand either, and they're both split to the left side, and Royer Tillman has it at the 31-yard line, but no timeouts remaining. Lewis Oliver makes the stop. Clock running with less than 25 seconds to go. Slack finally throws it out of bounds, so 13 seconds left to go, first half. And Taylor, the intended receiver, how does this set up, Lee?
Well, they still have time to throw a ball about 10 yards down the field and complete it if it's near the sideline to get out of bounds. But if the ball is in the middle, the half will be in.
You're looking at about a 50-yard field goal if the ball remains right here. Now it's third down. Third down and 4. Slack. And the catch is made by Taylor, but he gets maybe just a yard or two. Owen Bartroff, 29, was over on the coverage. He's an outside linebacker, but used to be a safety, and that means a field goal attempt and a long one coming up for Wynn Lyle, the junior from Auburn, Alabama. And they'll put the tee at the 37-yard line and make it a 47-yard attempt. His long this year has been 41 yards. That was a good snap. And it's short. 3 seconds. 3 seconds left to go, first half. So Auburn maintains a 3-0 lead, and tomorrow night at 8 Eastern time, join us for the Washington Redskins and the Houston Oilers as our NFL coverage resumes. And, of course, we'll take you throughout the remainder of the season. NFL primetime at 7. That's coming up tomorrow night here on ESPN.
Two of those coaches both have Southern roots. Joe Gibbs was an assistant at Florida State, and Jerry Glanville was an assistant at Georgia Tech.
And we're in Gainesville, and we got to go through Atlanta to get to wherever we want to go. 3 seconds left to go, first half. And as the horn sounds, a completed pass, but nothing doing as McGriff catches it. So Auburn still has not allowed a touchdown in the first half this year, and Florida has still allowed just one touchdown in the first half. A true defensive battle between these two Southeastern Conference rivals who have one loss apiece, as five teams do in the Southeastern Conference. Auburn leads Florida 3-0 on homecoming Saturday in Gainesville. Let's go to Tim Brando. Tim?
All right, Roger, thank you very much. You might have to go to the NFC Central Division to find a better defensive unit than the Auburn defense. That's a great one we have going on. We've got highlights from the USC-UCLA encounters.
And Johnson will kick it off for Auburn. Tony Lomac, number 20. And also Alonzo Sullivan, 86, back for the Florida Gators. 3-0. Auburn leads it. And Lomac, and they fake the reverse, and Lomac with a seam up the middle. Lomac with two men to beat. And he's brought down from behind at the 41-yard line, a 38-yard return. And Florida with some great field position. Alex Thomas made the tackle from behind.
A little razzle-dazzle. Lomac will start the ball to his left, fake the reverse play to number 86, gets a good block right here, avoids one man. Nice call by the Florida team to try to take the pressure away from the offense and give them good field position. Excellent call.
Tony Lomac, a wide receiver and also kick return specialist, as 19 Herbert Perry, who started the game, comes back out on the field. Lomac will split to the near side, and now there's some confusion on the Florida part, and they have to call a timeout on the first offensive play of the second half. Let's check out the stats from the first half, and to say it was a defensive-oriented first half would be the understatement of our college football season. Auburn in Florida. Pass completions, 5 of 10 Auburn, 5 of 13 Florida. Passing yards, 24 and 39. Rushing yards, 75 and just 5 for the University of Florida. Total yards, 99 and 44. Turnovers, 1 and 1. And this from teams, folks, Auburn averaging nearly 470 total yards a game, in Florida over 375.
Lynn Amity is talking to Perry over there, and he's telling him a real important point. We'll get to that in a second.
Today, 75,199, that's a Florida field attendance record, and we're delighted to be a part of it. First time ESPN's ever televised a game from Florida Field here in Gainesville.
And you know what? In 2 years, they hope to have the other end zone coverage and filled in. That'd be over 82,000 people.
Is that the north end zone?
Yes, right where the scoreboard is right there.
There you go, that open arc.
That'll be covered in.
First and 10 now, and Lomac goes in motion. And McClendon on a delayed pitch. Boy, there's just utter confusion right there. Now, they had a timeout because they were confused about the players they had in there. Then they run the play, and the players seemed confused.
This will happen when you try to get too fancy. They put a man in motion. They wanted to go to the right, but number 5, McClendon, must have thought it was to the left, and then it's all over, and he thought he was back at University Christian High School on that play. Not a very good way to start the second half for Galen Hall after the tremendous kickoff return.
Second down at 12. A 2-yard loss on that play. Just underway, second half. McClendon will pitch it back, and he gets nothing. As a matter of fact, he loses 2 yards. And that brings out a chorus of boos as 95 David Rocker makes a start. Let's look at plus yardage, minus yardage, and the scoring drive.
Florida, one, two, three, four punts in a row, then an interception, the fifth punt, an ending and a half. Thank goodness.
That's a lot of gray matter there, isn't it, Lee?
Their offense didn't do well, but remember, the score is only 3-0, and they're still in the ballgame.
Third down and 14 now from the 39-yard line. Kirkpatrick in motion. Screen to the near side. Cedric Smith with a seam, and he gets it to the 48. It's not nearly enough for the first down. So, boy, with a chance to really make something happen to start the second half. Florida won the toss, deferred, and consequently, that's why they received in the second half.
Tracy Walker, the left defensive tackle, gets good pressure. Number 72 has got good blocking position on him. The little screen out there, number 56, Hodge Reddit.
And back to punt is Hank Rone. That's R-O-N-E, number 10. A junior from Gainesville, and Wasden at the 20, and he is dropped. Alonzo Sullivan, 86 down there to make the tackle, 31 yards in the punt, 3 on the return, and now Auburn's possession.
A lot more gray. 2 punts, an interception. A punt, and then they come up with the field goal. Nice drive, 7-minute drive to get the field goal. Punt and missed a field goal.
Lee in 83, 84, and 85. Auburn led the Southeastern Conference in rushing with 312-yard average in that 85 season. Last year, they were last in the Southeastern Conference with just over 133 yards. As on the first play here, Stacy Danley takes it across the 25. It appears, though, that with Pat Sullivan coming in, trying to establish a passing attack, but in a game like this, they're going back on the ground.
They go back to what they do the best. The best thing they do is Danley, number 32, and Joseph, number 10, not Slack, number 17. In the pregame show, we talked about Florida should try to have Slack, number 17, beat them. They got a better chance to win.
Second down and 7. James Joseph, number 10, a lone setback. Slack nearly has it picked off. Is number 45, Pat Moore, the junior from Pensacola, was there on the coverage.
They went to the well one time too many. That's the same play they hit 3 times in a row. Watch Slack, but this time he's bird dogging it. Bird dog means he looks directly at the receiver, and that time 45 Moore got a good jump and almost picked it off.
Stacy Danley, an intended receiver, but Moore with a good job there. 51 tackles on the year on third down and 7 for Reggie Slack, the junior from Milton, Florida. They tried to screen it, and finally Danley breaks out. The Florida defensive line did not bite. They did not buy it at all, and that's why Danley had a hard time breaking out from the pack. And that brings up a fourth down. So once again, the defense is setting the tempo as we begin the second half in Gainesville, Florida. Brian Shulman, the senior from Brentwood, Tennessee, at his own 10-yard line. And back deep at the 30 for Florida is Tony Lomack. Good punt. Lomack at the 25. And Lomack decides to go north as he gets to the 33, 49 yards in the punt, 7 on the return. Tom Garner, 46, down to make the stop. Auburn leads it 3-0. Today's game is being brought to you by Dodge Cars and Trucks. On the street or off the road, it's the new spirit of Dodge. By Allied Van Lines, the one America trusts. And by Britannia, live in Britannia. Roger Twybo, Lee Corso with you. Florida Field, Gainesville, Florida. Record crowd on hand. Homecoming Saturday. Auburn leads it 3-0. The Gators' second possession of the second half. And Herbert Perry still in there at quarterback. First and 10 from the 33. Penalty marker down. Sneed has it at the 45 and to the 42-yard line. But there is a penalty marker down.
Roger, most of the time a penalty like this with a man in motion will have the Florida man moving towards the line of scrimmage before the ball is snapped. Illegal procedure, 5-yard penalty.
26 yards on the pickup, their biggest offensive play of the day. Galen Hall.
An illegal procedure against the offense, didn't have a 6 men on the line of scrimmage. He'll be first down.
You've got to have a total of at least seven men on the line of scrimmage. Five of them are ineligible. Those men are all fine, but their wideouts were both in the backfield, which made it an illegal procedure. That man in motion should have been on the line of scrimmage, and that would have been number seven.
Five-yard penalty, so that'll bring up a first down and 15. What about the play, though, that they just ran?
Good play. Doesn't count.
A little more simple, not as many men in motion. 11:41 to go. Third quarter. Cedric Smith. Maybe to the line of scrimmage. It's tough running. They only got 5 yards rushing in the first half, and that starts the booze now from the record crowd here.
The reason the Florida team has got to run some is to keep Rocker, Roland, and Stalwart from smashing the quarterback on the pass rush. You've got to try to get some balance in football, and that's what Florida's trying to do right now.
Was that Rocker and Roland? Is that...
Good one.
Second and 15. Kirkpatrick in motion. Ball is knocked loose and recovered. David Williams, 73, was a man that fell on it, but once again, it had happened in the first half. As Perry was back to pass, the ball was knocked loose.
From the top of your picture, they're coming from the outside. This time, Rocker, number 74, beat 72 Durden, and number 73 alertly drops on the football. That's what I was talking about. The reason why you have to run is to keep those guys from just rushing the passer and going after them all the time.
So that brings up a third down and 25. So once again, good field position for Florida, and they're not able to do much with it. Setback is Smith. Quick out this time, and he finds his man, and that's Darrell Woolard, the H-back. He's a kind of a tight end wide receiver. As a matter of fact, Woolard was on the scout team, and they were so hungry for players, they brought him off the scout team. Not nearly enough for the first down, and that'll bring up a punting situation for the Florida Gators with 9:59 to go. Third quarter, and Fernando Acosta Rua will stand at his 15. And Shane Wasden, the freshman from Selma, Alabama, at his 40. Better punt that time. Wasden will get it back to the 40-yard line. So now Auburn with good field position as Greg Baldwin makes a stop. 35 yards of the punts of the kicking game has hurt Florida today. Want to remind you again, coming up tomorrow night at 8 Eastern time, the Washington Redskins and the Houston Oilers. You want to watch a good offense. Today, Jerry Glanville has got a wide-open offense in Houston. Of course, Joe Gibbs, always a great offense. Mark Rippon's done a great job. Doug Williams is back now from his appendectomy. Primetime at 7. NFL action at 8. Right here, Auburn leading it 3-0. First and 10 in the 40-yard line. Danley across midfield. Look at that run inside the 45 to the 43-yard line. Stacy Danley, 17 yards on the pickup.
Danley's a strong runner. The offensive right side of Shelby and Gardner do a nice job. Florida's defense could be getting tired. Number 67, the left guard. Watch him. This looks like an instant replay of the first half. 67 gets in the way. The fullback makes a good block, and there goes Danley. You notice Auburn immediately went back to what went well for them in the first half.
James Joseph took out two men with his block that time. First and 10 from the 43. Slack throws it downfield. He was looking for Lawyer Tillman. Huey Richardson was the man putting a lot of pressure on Reggie Slack. Auburn has been a big play, surprisingly enough, Lee, a big play football team this year.
And they get the big plays from Joseph. He had an 85-yard reception versus Kansas and a 76-yard run versus Kansas. Most people get great runs and passes versus Kansas.
Well, the 56-7 was that final. Auburn beat Kansas. Second down and 10. Looking for the screen, and Slack is dumped. 68, Rondy Weston, and 96, Jeff Robb. That's going to be a half sack apiece.
tremendous defensive play in the middle. Watch number 93, Armstrong, but number 68, Weston, does what they call an inside move. He faked to the outside, come to the inside, made a terrific play.
And he went by the freshman, Ed King, that time. Are you surprised after that run by Danley, they come and try to throw it two times in a row?
No, what they tried to do, which was a very good point, they tried to think of the Danley and throw it, try to get a long touchdown. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
There have been more third down and 22, 25, and 30 yards today. This is third and 22. Draw play to Danley. Rondy Weston stops him at the 41-yard line, and Auburn will have to punt.
Armstrong gets a piece of it, but 68, Weston, nice play.
Brian Shulman, beautiful punt that time. Terrence Barber at the 9-yard line. He didn't go anywhere, so he just goes out of bounds at the 11. Lamar Woodson, Kenneth Hicks down there on the special teams, 46 yards on the punt. 3-0, Auburn leads Florida. Roger Twyba, Lee Corso back with you in Gainesville. Auburn leading it 3-0. The punter, Brian Shulman, has done a great job for Auburn today.
Poor snap. He gets it off, punts the ball down the 11-yard line. Remember, they got 89 yards to go. That's why they play such great defense. They never give the other team good position.
He's had six punts inside the 10 and 10 inside the 20 this year, and McClendon goes absolutely nowhere as Tracy Rocker rocks him at the 6-yard line. McClendon has negative yards rushing today.
From the right-hand side of your picture, you'll watch number 74. He does what they call an inside move on number 77, Ismail, and it's all over. Poor McClendon never had a chance on that one. Tracy Rocker just caught him before he had any chance to move forward.
Remember, both of these teams with just one loss in the Southeastern Conference, and both Alabama and LSU winners today. Georgia playing William & Mary in a non-conference game. So somebody's going to have a couple of losses after this contest this afternoon as Perry is going deep. He's got a man. Perry's got Willie Snead momentarily, but what a great play by Shan Morris. It was right there in his hands, and it looked like Snead was headed for six, and Morris took it away.
Perry threw this ball perfect to Snead. You'll see it on the left-hand side of your picture. They're playing two deep zone. Number 20's got that part of the field. He gets a jump on the ball, and he dives and leaves his feet and knocks the ball down. What a tremendous play by Morris. Notice he's got two deep coverage, and he dives, extends himself, and knocks the ball out down. But again, nice pass by Perry.
Snead thought he had it because he kept running. Third down and 13. And a timeout. Boy, once again, confusion as Perry, only 10 players on the field that time, Lee. One of the Florida players come running off the field, and Perry looked over, and he only had 10, so he called a timeout. Boy, that was 21 McNabb that came off, and there's a lot of confusion, which leads me to the question. Football is a lot of injuries. First, let's go to Tim Brando, though.
As we told you, Roger, at halftime, Iowa, well, they could come back. Watch Chuck Hartley go to work.
Pretty much the question is, Lee, every football team has injuries. Everyone has problems. You lose players. Could it be that the offense that you have in is too complicated? Why can't these kids pick it up when they come in?
It's obviously with the off week that Florida put in too much for the Florida players to comprehend. It was excellent on the blackboard, but not very good on the field.
Third down and 13. Perry scrambles. He's got room. A penalty marker is down. He doesn't get the first down territory as John Wiley stops him. But a penalty marker, and you got to assume that it's going to be holding as it was back where all those orange shirts were trying to stop all those white shirts coming in. And it's been a tough day for Herbert Perry.
It's been a tough day for that gentleman, Galen Hall. He's trying to figure out a way to take inferior offense.
And holding on the offense on the play. The penalty is declined. It's going to be fourth down.
He's trying to find a way to take inferior offensive personnel and beat superior defensive personnel, and that is very difficult.
Fernando Acosta-Rua, who has not had a good day punting in his own end zone, and Shane Wasden at the 47-yard line. 6:44 left to go, third quarter. Watson at the 50. There's a low punt, so he'll bring it back, and he gets it to the 43-yard line. Brent Ellis makes the tackle, just 37 yards on the punt and 7 on the return. 32 left to go, third quarter. Homecoming Saturday, Florida Field in Gainesville. A record crowd, and Auburn has a first and 10. And Stacy Danley again. They have made some good yardage, Lee, on first down with Danley.
And off the right side all the time. The left guard pulls number 67, but the right tackle and right end do a good job. You watch number 67 pull. He traps the linebacker, number 45, Moore, and that's why the play works. Number 24, Lang, has to make a drag down tackle.
A gain of 9, second and 1. Blitzing this time, and a great job by the Florida defense. And the man who came busting through was number 49 for the Gators, Joey Nicoletto, a 50-year senior from Tampa.
He played at Chamberlain High School, which is one of the best high schools in Florida. He takes a calculated risk by blitzing on second and short yardage, and 49 catches the back before he can make the movement.
Nicoletto came into the game with 41 tackles, a couple of interceptions, and one sack. And from a second and 1, it's now 3rd and 6. Listen to the crowd. They're on their feet now. Swing pass to Stacy Danley. One good move to spin and not enough for the first down as he gets to the 37-yard line. This has been a chess match.
Absolutely.
Second and 1. You figure maybe they'll go for a bomb. Maybe they'll try to get an easy one. Now Shulman's on the field to punt it.
But Pat Dye is worried. The longer you leave Florida in this game here in Gainesville, the better chance they have to beat Auburn.
Shulman at his 48. Beautiful high spiraling kick that angles to the near sideline. Look at this. And it is down at the 1-yard line. It was John Wiley who came and caught it before it hit the ground. And once again, Florida is going to start from deep in their own territory. 36 yards in the punt, and Shulman has done a tremendous job today. The kicking game so far, you've got to give the nod to Auburn.
Absolutely. He's an all-Southeastern Conference kicker, and you can see this is a beautiful play. It's perfectly legal for number 9, Wiley, to go down and catch this ball if there's no Florida man in the picture, and there isn't. That's why this is perfectly legal. Now, there's two things Florida can do. One, they can throw a bomb and try to get a 99-yard touchdown, or watch out, they might get a safety against them.
Herbert Perry, still the quarterback, and they'll just hand it right up the middle. That was Dexter McNabb, a 6'1", 232-pound freshman, as David Rocker, 95, makes a stop with 4:25 left to go, third quarter. Auburn leads Florida 3-0. There has been just one solid drive all day, and that was the start.
Now, you see number 3 right there, Roger? Number 3 is coming in the game, if our information is correct, and they got time to do it, to run a tailback pass.
So Terrence Barber will split way out to the far side. They hand it right up to McNabb, and he gets possibly to the line of scrimmage. Once again, the middle is in there with Craig Ogletree, 94, from his outside linebacker. He moves up on the line of scrimmage on these goal line situations.
But they're doing a smart thing here. They're giving the ball to the fullback. You notice they're giving the ball to number 21 there, McNabb, so they don't give the ball to the tailback back in the end zone where they can get a safety. At least they'll move the ball out and get the chance to punt it.
He's got time. He was trying to find Barber, but 94 Ogletree was right back on the coverage and no chance. So 3 downs and a punt, and this has been a problem for Florida. Acosta Rua has just not done the solid job, but he's been back in the end zone a lot, too, and it's never easy to punt out of there.
One of the reasons why this is most difficult for Florida is if they try to block longer, sometimes a team can get a great punt return on you from this position right here.
He got some height on that punt. Wasden with a fair catch at the 39-yard line. 37 yards on the punt. As I was mentioning earlier, there's really only been one solid drive. That was by Auburn in the second quarter that went down and got them their field goal. They consumed, 7 minutes and 1 second. And they'll have it now with great field position at 2:59 to go in the third. Let's go to Tim Brando. Tim?
All right, Roger, and one.
Tim, an upset in the making there in L.A. And Auburn with their best field position of the second half. And it's Stacy Danley to the 35, and they have running now, Lee, on first down on three consecutive series.
And they're running off tackle, trying to knock the Florida team back off the ball, but number 90 that time, Richardson, came from the backside and made a tremendous play.
Richardson, 30 tackles, a couple of sacks, and an interception, and it's second and six. Stacy Danley again. Danley to the 25-yard line and an Auburn first down before Lewis Oliver makes the stop. 10 yards on the pickup. And how long can this Florida defense hold up?
Not much longer. You'd be surprised. This is exactly the same play. Number 86, good block reads. Number 67, King, good block. Danley running straight ahead. It looked like Auburn would be smart and run that play 10 times in a row and see what happens.
Danley, 16 carries, 90 yards. He came into this game. 69 carries, 526 yards. First down and 10. And they just go up the gut again. Nothing fancy about it. A gain of about four as Jeff Roth, 96, and Pat Moore, 45, make the tackle.
It's important here for Florida to play very tough defense and force the field goal because a 6-0 deficit is not bad for Florida, but a 10-0 deficit with their offense is almost suicide.
Let me tell you something here about Auburn. 15 times they've been inside the opposition's 23-yard line, and they didn't come away with a touchdown. On second and 7, Joseph. And he is dropped at the 15-yard line. Richard Fain makes a tackle. Once again, 15 times inside the opposition 23-yard line, and they didn't come away with a touchdown.
They run the same play 3 times. I said 10 times in a row. They won't do it, but it's the same basic off-tackle play. Number 40, Strong, gets a good block on the linebacker from Florida, and there goes Auburn. Same basic theory.
Another first down, first and 10. At the 15, Stacy Danley, he gets 3. To the 12, Roth, then Trace Armstrong, 93. Well, that's a football sounding name, isn't it, Trace Armstrong? You know he's from Alabama.
Birmingham, Alabama.
Interesting story. Trace Armstrong, that is. Arizona State University, tremendous player. The top defensive player on the Arizona State team. And because of a grade problem in high school, was told he couldn't play at ASU, but anywhere else in the country, transferred this year, and has had a great job with the Florida Gators as Stacy Danley is inside the 10 to the 8. Trace Armstrong has been one of their leaders. Lewis Oliver, their other leader on defense, number 18 in the secondary.
Boy, that was a classic. That was a classic collision between 18 Oliver and 32 Danley.
And that ends the third quarter of play. We'll be back with the final 15 as Auburn leads Florida 3-0. Florida Field, Gainesville, Florida, on homecoming Saturday. Roger Twyla, Lee Corso with you. Auburn leads it as we start the fourth quarter 3-0. They've got a third down and 4. Stacy Danley, penalty marker is down. There was movement on the left side of the Auburn line. It's interesting because Lee going into that end zone, the north end zone, that's all Auburn fans.
And it's open. It shouldn't be as loud. But can you believe it?
Left tackle, keep going. Offense, line the move before the snap. Still be third down.
Keep your eyes. by the left side of the line, number 54 Thompson or 67 King move on the left side prior to the snap.
Third down and nine. Florida needs to hold them here. They don't want Auburn to get anything, but I'll tell you, if they can only come away with them getting three, that's a moral victory for them. Reggie Slack down the middle. Reggie Slack to Walter Reeves is tight end, but it's not going to be enough for the first down. Ephesians Bartley was the man that made the tackle.
Reggie Slack goes back to pass. He's got his tight end in the middle watching him. You see him all the way. Nice hand by Reeves, but not quite far enough.
There might have been a flag on that. There might have been a little contact before the pass. Nonetheless, that brings in Wynn Lyle. 23-yard attempt. And it's good. 14-21. Left to go. Fourth quarter. And Auburn with a 6-0 lead over the Florida Gators. Today's game is being brought to you by Volvo, a car you can believe in. And by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. Roger Tribal and Lee Corso with you from a record-breaking crowd at Florida Field in Gainesville, 75,199. And Tony Lomac from the four. Lomac across the 25 to the 26-yard line. And Auburn with a 6-0 lead. Lomac 22 yards on the return. Lee, we've seen them try to run it. They can't do it. We've seen them try to pass it. Every once in a while, glitter of hope. What do you do then?
First of all, you start throwing on first and 10, and you throw real quick passes before the Auburn lineman can get to them. Run a couple of screens and draws. Try to play for field position. Hope Auburn turns the ball over and beat them 7-6 in the last minute.
Lomac splits out to the top of your screen along with Mark McGriff. Willie Snead to the near side on first and 10. Perry going for some quick stuff, and he's got Snead. And Perry took a big hit. Alvin Mitchell came busting through, but just as you said, a quick out, a little yardage, a little confidence builder.
That's right. They got to keep doing it over and over again, but be careful. Auburn has a tendency to change coverages, and they can go for the pickoff. And if they get a turnover here and stick another one in, Florida is dead.
Perry, 8 of 16 for 63 yards. Second down and 7. Ron Stallworth with his fifth sack of the year.
92, Ron Stallworth, 6'5", 258 senior from Pensacola, Florida, crushes Perry, crushes him.
Well, he got rid of the football, so it's not a sack. It's going to be third down.
96, Roland does a nice little thing, doesn't he? He plays the nose tackle, and he dropped back right underneath the tight end. Nice defensive call by the Auburn defense.
Kyle Morris, number one, comes in. I can't believe Perry got rid of that football. Third down and 7. Snead has got the first down at the 43-yard line. Willie Snead.
Nice call by the secondary. It's good defensive call, but watch the top right-hand side of your picture. Good call. A rollout and a simple out cut. Nice and soft completion to 9, Willie Snead, a transfer from the University of Virginia. Good play, Florida.
Boy, they protected the quarterback by letting him roll out that time. First and 10 from the 42. Looking near side. Morris really fired it into Lomac, and he couldn't hold on to it. Lomac was right down by first down territory. And that'll bring up a second down with 13:55. Kyle Morris came into this game 61 of 114 with three touchdowns and 7 interceptions. He had completed 53% of his passes coming into the game. He had started six of the previous seven games for the Gators.
Intercepted. Intercepted by Quentin Riggins. And Morris pulls him out of bounds. A penalty marker goes down as he got him by the face mask at the 18-yard line. First interception of the year for Quentin Riggins, the junior from Montgomery.
Number 41, Riggins drops back in the middle. Morris wants to throw the ball to the tight end. If you watch him, he's looking right over the middle of the field to the tight end. He does not see number 41. Riggins, who jumps in front of him, he takes off to the nearest sideline. Morris knocks him out of bounds, but gets the face mask and an extra five-yard penalty. This is the break that Auburn was looking for, but they got to stick it in, Roger. 3 points is not enough anymore.
13:44 left to go, and once again, the Florida defense will be faced with a major challenge. And Galen Hall pacing the sideline. They have lost two games in a row. Memphis State and Vanderbilt, two teams that shouldn't have beat them. They don't match up with them on paper, yet they did. And off week, they trail 6-0. Stacy Danley tripped up on a great play by Joey Nicoletto, number 49. Once again, that's the second time, Lee, he's come busting through into the backfield.
The Florida defensive coaches have decided, number one, that they've got to put the pressure on him. You notice the concentration on slack. But notice number 49, Nicoletto, he was into the backfield. That's the only way they're going to be able to stop all of them is to hit him before they start running.
And Pat Dye and his coordinators, a little discussion on the sideline. Second and 12. Double tight ends. Little misdirection. Danley nearly trips. Danley, touchdown Auburn. Touchdown of the year for Stacy Danley.
Why did this work? It was a little misdirection play. Great call. He almost stumbled. 78. Shelby gets a good block, knocks the man down. It's a touchdown. The reason that play was great, it was misdirection. Started one way and went back the other way.
Wynn Lyle, the extra point, and it's good. So Auburn, in less than 2 minutes, a field goal, an extra touchdown, and they lead it 13-0. Now we've got to start 30 to the 32-yard line.
Replays. Watch. He's faking the ball to the right and they're running a misdirection play. The reason why this play is a great play is because it faked the play that Auburn had been doing so well to the right and came back with a misdirection. On the second look, right, they're trying to the right. All of a sudden, boom, they come back to the left. 78, Shelby gets a good block, and it's touchdown Auburn.
Florida, first and 10. From the 32-yard line, Herbert Perry back in at quarterback, and they hand it up the middle. Tracy Rocker, though, was there to meet Cedric Smith as the scoring drive. Two plays, 9 yards, 41 seconds, and 11 yards on the touchdown run. Got some room outside. He's got the first down to the 45-yard line. Let's go to Tim Brando. Tim?
Roger, we could have a new number.
Wild, wild west. First and 10 for Florida. They trail 13-0. 11:48 to go, fourth quarter. And Perry coming near side. He's got Kirk Kirkpatrick, his tight end, who's across midfield to the 48-yard line. Kirkpatrick, just 6 receptions on the season. Coming into the game is knocked out by Greg Staples and Quentin Riggins.
Nice play fake. The fake of the fullback holds the linemen in so they don't come after Perry so fast. He throws a long shot across to Kirkpatrick. Good play.
Pat Dye told us yesterday, Lee, that his starting defensive unit has allowed just 2 touchdowns this year. That's an incredible statistic. Allowing just 8.5 points per game, that's number 1 in the nation. Second and 3. McClendon's got a hole.
Well, the freshman showed you maybe a few too many moves there with no real reason to.
But also shows you the great quickness of 94 Ogletree and the inside linebackers. The hole was there, but before McClendon could do anything, watch 94, watch 41, watch 56. They're all there. Great defensive pursuit by the Auburn Tigers.
The Florida Gators with just one loss as Auburn has never won an official Southeastern Conference title. In 84, they were 5-0-1, but that was the year they were on NCAA and Southeastern Conference probation. So they didn't get it. They've never, ever won it. They still got a shot, but they're down 13-0. The pass intended for Snead is broken up. It would have been enough for the first down as Greg Staples, 45, the strong safety on the coverage. And once again, the punting unit will come out for the Florida Gators. And 10, Hank Rome, who handles the short punting, but now they've got him in on a long punt situation. He's standing at his 37-yard line, and back deep is Wasden at the 15. Wasden with a fair catch at the 13-yard line. 36 yards on the punt. Pat Dye and his team 6-1 this year. The beauty of it, 6 home games. They beat Kentucky, good Kentucky team. Kansas, Tennessee, and then North Carolina on the road at LSU. They lose, but they're the Oral Hershiser of college football. They came into this game pitching a couple of shutouts, and they've got one here today, 13-0 against Florida.
The last three games are Southern Mississippi, Georgia, and Alabama at Birmingham.
So a great home schedule for Auburn this year. 10:49 left to go. First and 10 from the 13. Stacy Danley to the 24-yard line. A penalty marker's down as Kerry Watkins took the front of that punishment. This is a good-looking back right there. He can run inside, he can run outside, and he can run over you, more important than everything else.
He missed spring practice with the knee out.
An offensive holding on the run. He has to miss the penalty to the goal line, still first down.
So holding on the run, half the distance to the goal line. Well, look, I want to get something straight here on Auburn. You know, they've had a lot of nicknames through the years, but they are officially the Tigers. Now, they were called the War Eagles, but that's a school battle cry. And the Plainsmen, but that's from Auburn being the loveliest village on the plains. So they just want to be known as the Tigers, and let's not get any other confusion about that. First down. And 17. Misdirection play, and Stacy Danley gets out to the 10-yard line. Gain of about 3. Pat Moore, 45, and Joey Nicoletto, 49, on the tackle.
Auburn is going to the right side, going to the right side, and running a misdirection play to the left side. The reason why the misdirection is good now is because Florida is flowing towards the fullback on their first key, and the misdirection is a very fine play when their linebackers are keying the fullback.
Second down and 13. One wide receiver, two tight ends, and Danley trips up at the middle of the 10. Now, Lee, I'm curious. The right guard for Auburn that time never got down into a three-point stance. He was standing straight up while the rest of the front all down in the three-point stance.
Sometimes the lineman will get in a two-point stance and indicate pass. The reason you don't get into a three-point stance sometimes is they can't key you every time you're in a two-point stance, you throw the football. That's why the right guard was in a two-point stance.
Third down and 13 for Auburn. 9:23 left to go. They lead Florida 13-0. Stacy Danley again. Danley carrying people out to the 14-yard line. And Auburn will have to punt the football, and Florida should get good field position. Joey Nicoletto and this Florida defense, just a tremendous effort.
See all the offensive linemen, they're all in a two-point stance. That indicates pass to Florida defense, but all of a sudden, watch the Auburn right side pull on the misdirection play. That's what they call a key breaker.
It's easier to pull standing up as Shulman with a beautiful punt. Barber at the 41-yard line, and Barber gets out of bounds at the 49. So 43 yards on the punt, 8 on the return, 8:33 left to go, and Auburn leads Florida 13-0. Roger Twyba, Lee Corso with you. Florida Field in Gainesville. And the Gators have a first and 10 from midfield. They trail 13 to nothing. Herbert Perry, the quarterback, and the intended receiver was Mark McGriff, the tight end, coming to the near side. Boy, a lot of pressure on Herbert Perry and even Kyle Morris, the young man that came in dispelling briefly.
A lot of pressure on a quarterback when you can't establish a running game. All the defensive linemen just run a straight line right after you. That's why it's so important that you get balance in great football teams, being able to run and throw.
Second down and 10. Lomack and Sneed split to the top of your screen. Willie McClendon with a hole. McClendon across the 45 to the 44-yard line. Ron Stallworth makes the stop, and let's go to Tim Brando. Tim?
Roger, we will have a new number one. Fourth down, Troy Aikman from the 6-yard line sends a man in motion and then lofts one for David Keating, broken up by Brett Collins and Dennis Erickson's Cougars.
I can tell you they'll have a party in the Palouse tonight. Third down and 4 and nearly intercepted. Nearly picked off by Smokey Hodge, number 56. The pass intended for Darrell Woolard.
You notice the spot? It's exactly the same spot that number 41 Riggins intercepted the ball. The quarterback is bird-dogging him. He's watching the man all the way, and 56 Hodge almost got the interception.
And Herbert Perry calls a timeout with a fourth down and 4. Upcoming for the Florida Gators. They trail it 13-0.
I don't want him.
Well, behind the highway patrolman over there is Brian Schulman, number one, who has been a top punter in the Southeastern Conference. 8 punts today, average of 42 yards, as long as 15. He's had 4 inside the 20. Fourth down and 4 for Florida. Nearly intercepted again. Carlo Cheatham, number 35, nearly picks it off on fourth down. And Florida had to go for it with 7:35 left.
Good call. They went to a safe play. They rolled the quarterback out, which should give Perry more pressure. He's getting some pressure from the inside by 96 Roland. Nice play by Carlo Cheatham, number 35, who intercepted 2 passes last year against Florida.
And what a modest guy. They, for 2 years, called him Carlos, and he finally came up to him and says, gee, I hope you don't mind, but you've been misspelling my name. He says, my name is Carlo. Stacy Danley across the 45 to the 47-yard line. You know, Florida and Auburn have played some great football games. As a matter of fact, one of the greatest games in Florida history, well, the greatest game in Florida history, and for Galen Hall as a coach, occurred 3 years ago when Florida beat Auburn 14-10, and they took over for the first time ever, number one in the AP rankings. It was short-lived because they had Georgia next week. They lost to them 24-3. Florida, next week, Georgia in Jacksonville. That was the high point in Florida Gator football history, and that means coaching career. 7 minutes left to go. 13-0 Auburn. And just give it to Danley again as he gets up to the 49-yard line. Trace Armstrong, 93, makes the stop.
Trace Armstrong has been playing very, very well. Now they're trying to run away from him. He gets away, sheds the man, and comes down the line of scrimmage, 93, and tackles Danley. Very nice play by Armstrong.
Florida has no timeouts remaining with 6:26 left to go. 3rd and 5 for Auburn. Weygand in motion to the far side. Slack is nailed by Trace Armstrong from behind, and the pass goes incomplete. So Reggie Slack has not really distinguished himself. I think that Florida has done a great job against him. They haven't stopped Danley, though.
They haven't stopped 93 Armstrong either. What a great competitor he is. He beats 76 Gardner to the outside and then breaks down and gets Slack from the outside.
Schulman from his 35. A lot of pressure. Beautiful, high, spiraling punt. And Barber, the fair catch at the 12. And Schulman has done his job today keeping Florida pinned deep 39 yards on that punt.
The gentleman that works with the kicking game is Paul. six-year coach. He was the former head coach at Mississippi State. He's a real veteran. He's done a tremendous job with the Auburn kicking game.
6:07 left to go. Auburn leads it 13-0. Remember, Florida, no timeouts, and the last shutout at home was in 79 against Alabama, 40-0. The last time Florida was shut out was in 82. Georgia beat them 44-0. And McClendon will try to run with it, and that's just a dead issue right there, folks. I mean, with 6 minutes to go, why even pretend?
Well, the reason why they're pretending, they probably got Georgia next week, and hopefully to get out of here without getting everybody killed, especially number five, McClendon, who gets to go home next week against Georgia and Jacksonville, and maybe he'll have a better chance. Georgia is not as good a defensive football team as Auburn. The only advantage Auburn has is the rest of the year they don't have to play Auburn again.
Riggins, 41, Brown, 38, in on that last tackle, 2nd and 10. Lomac is in motion. Perry, the barber, and he overthrows him. John Wiley, 9, back on the coverage. They've tried to go deep just one time today, and that was the great defensive play made by Shan Morris, number 20, who you see in the picture behind Wiley right there. That is the only time Florida has gone deep today.
You know, that could have been the turning point in this game.
Mm-hmm.
If Florida would have scored
6-0 at that time.
That's right. They would have went ahead 7-6. The crowd would have been back in there. You never know. That play by Morris will go unlooked, except by the purists who watch football all the time.
3rd down and 10. 5:22 left. Deflected at the line of scrimmage. 92, Ron Stallworth, and 96, Benji Rowland with the two men there.
Stallworth, 92. He knows. He's licking his chops. He's got a chance to get number 79 there and whip it to the inside. But watch. Tracy Rocker is almost leading the team in interception. Oh, he thought he had himself one and scored 6.
4th and 10, 5:17 to go. And our two most popular guys, Fernando Acosta-Rua and Rome. And this is Acosta-Rua and Watson, the fair catch at the 42-yard line. I'll tell you, the freshman does a good job on punts. Shane Watson, 30 yards on that punt. And Florida looking at their 3rd consecutive loss. Looking to make it 7-1, and so it would be a 4-way tie in the Southeastern Conference with Georgia, Auburn, Alabama, and LSU.
One thing about Auburn, I really do feel like they've got to develop more balance. I think they're going to have to throw the ball more effectively against great football teams to beat them.
We're not going to throw it now with 5:09 to go. James Joseph, and he's tripped up at the 40. 24, Bill Lang, strong side safety, came up to make the tackle. I'd like to remind you again that on Sunday night at 8 Eastern time, the Washington Redskins and the Houston Oilers will tee it up right here on ESPN NFL Primetime with Chris and Pete and Tom and John will be along, and then Mike Patrick and Joe Theismann will have that game for you.
Talk about some hitting, Roger. Those Houston Oilers will really smack you. So if you like good hitting games, be sure to watch that.
4:33 left to go. Alexander Wright is the man in motion. The handoff, James Joseph. Inside the 25 to the 22-yard line as he went over the right side. And Richard Fain finally made the tackle. 17 yards in the pickup as a large continued from Auburn here going wide.
Watch the concentration on slack. He's calling the signals. He's going to get the ball as deep as he can to Joseph. They had a blitz on number 49, Nicoletto. Blitzed and got himself right out of the play. Joseph's turn to run now. Danley is tired for running. Now take it over, Joseph.
Selby, 78, Garner, 76, John Hudson, 66, from Paris, Tennessee. The center said, the reason I went to Auburn, they had the fewest traffic lights of any school I went to. He says, I'm not a big city kind of guy, and he made a big block on that play. Now, the misdirection. Danley, look at him run inside the 10, down to the 7-yard line, and he's going to go over to the sideline because he came up holding his hip, and the way he landed, that could have been a hit pointer.
It could be, and he ran right over. number 24, Lang, one of the toughest players that Florida has. Misdirection play. Here comes 24. Blank. He ran right over him. Keeps good body lean. Falls on his hip. But yeah. I tell you what, he better get well quick because they're going to give the ball to Joseph, and he's going to score.
27 carries, 132 yards for Stacy Danley. 3:30 left, 13-0 Auburn. And James Joseph down to the 6-yard line. Loose football. And apparently the ground caused the fumble as Auburn will maintain possession. So trouble in Gatorland. Man, they put up a great fight here tonight, Lee, on homecoming. And it's always tough to play Auburn on homecoming.
Number 93 gets a good knock on the man. Looks like it was a fumble because it looks like the ground did not cause it. But Auburn would have recovered it anyhow.
Stacy Danley right up the middle. And he's down to the two.
Coming right at you, folks. Look at the eyes, the slack. He calls the automatic. He's running right at number 99, Polk. And there goes Danley right after him. What has happened now is the Florida team has just run out of gas. They've just been on the field so long. Anytime your offense doesn't move the ball, your defense has to play so much, they cannot stop it.
Third and goal from the 2-yard line. Stacy Danley is tripped up on a nice play. It looked like Richard Fain came over from his cornerback spot, got his ankle. And it was indeed Fain. And so fourth down. Pat Dye, Galen Hall, both pace the sidelines. And Jan Morris right there, who made the big tackle. This will be a field goal attempt. Win Lyle, 20 yards. And leads it 16-0, and both coaches told us it would be the kicking game and turnovers, and Auburn, three field goals from that man, Win Lyle, and great punting from Shulman, and they lead it 16-0 with 1:37 left to go. These are some of the Auburn backs in the NFL. Brent Fullwood, Tommy Agee, James Brooks, Joe Cripps, Bo Jackson, who also plays pro baseball, Lionel Little Train James, and Tim Jesse. And Tim Jesse, you'll see tomorrow night here on ESPN.
Well, when you put the game in proper perspective, the team with the best football players won, Auburn. The team that had a good football team but didn't have them all here today, Florida lost. It's just exactly what we thought would happen.
As you said at the top, you put the two teams on paper side by side, there's no way Auburn can lose. I asked you, how do they lose if they shoot themselves in the foot? And they did.
And they did. But Florida played a gallant game defensively, but just wore out at the end of the ball game. That's all. But I will say this again, before Auburn hits that last part of the schedule, unless they develop some kind of a passing attack with Reggie Slack, good football teams are going to shut their running game down, and they could be in big trouble.
Chris Johnson to kick it off. And they fake the reverse. Sneed has one man to beat. And nine, John Wiley tackles nine, Willie Sneed. And a great return right there. Just a little bit of excitement, but not too much here for Florida.
Well, they're faking the reverse play to get all those headhunters from Auburn to chase the man that's not had the ball. But now Steve makes a good move. As I mentioned before, he was a transfer from the University of Virginia, and he's down the sideline. Good play, two times, two reverses, both good yardage, and then absolutely nothing happens.
Florida, no timeouts left, 1:28 to go. Auburn leads it 16-0. Florida will go down to their third consecutive defeat. They'll have two losses in the Southeastern Conference. As Perry finds his man on the far side, that's Terrence Barber. And no team in the 54-year history of the Southeastern Conference has ever won the title with two losses. And 1:19 left.
Last time shut out Florida was 1963 at Auburn, 19-0. This game, 16-0. Willie McClendon. And the freshman has had a long, long day. Stallworth and Rocker both in on the tackle.
Auburn plays defense like you're supposed to play it. Number 74 gets a good pursuit angle. The whole team runs over there. Number 94 Ogletree's in on it. 92 Stallworth from Pensacola, Florida's in there. They play defense up front as good as any team in the country. Watch number 74 as he sheds a tackler and gets around there. Good play, Auburn.
Florida had won three of the last four games. Auburn the winner last year. And Pat Dye will pick up his first victory ever in Gainesville against the Gators. And that's going to be picked off. Perry's pack is picked off. Number 42, Doug Huntley. That's his second interception this year, the senior from Montgomery, Alabama. And that's been the story of the day for the offense of the University of Florida. Totally in it.
And this is why. Number 74, Rocker. Number 92, Stallworth. Perry will think there's seven 74s in his sleep tonight. Huntley just plays his zone. Perry is pressured, throws an interception. Florida's got a tough remaining schedule also. It won't be easy.
And with 16 seconds left, they'll just sit on it. The last time Auburn shut out three consecutive opponents was back in 74 when they beat Tennessee Chattanooga 52-0, University of Tennessee 21-0, and the University of Miami 3-0. And that's it. Auburn has spoiled Florida's homecoming, their third straight shutout. Auburn beats Florida 16-0. Stacy Danley with a tremendous day running the football. The two kickers, Wynn Lyle, the place kicker, with three field goals. And then Brian Schulman, the punter. The kicking game, no mistakes. And the defense that has given up the fewest points in the nation, 8.5 a game, well, they have just improved that. Let's go to Tim Brando. Tim?
All right, Roger, thank you very much. The first of two, count them, two big games we have got for you tonight. Of course, South Carolina and North Carolina State are on the way.